What you're about to experience is one man's quest to see beyond the tumultuous period we're in and to envision what lies just beyond our grasp, yet well within our reach. Welcome to Larry Rifkin's America Trends, where the future has arrived, and it's just in time.
Welcome back to America Trends. John Kropsik and me, Larry Rifkin. I hope you're well today. And thank you so much for listening to our podcast. And we'd love to know that we're doing some things right for you. So please use our social media at Trends Podcast and let us know what you're thinking. Get engaged in all the activity we have for you. Now, John, we take on all kinds of topics, as you know.
We sure do.
But we got a big fish.
Oh, well, this should be a good one.
Well, Michael O'Hanlon, and I have read his material over the years. He's with the very prestigious Brookings Institution. And we've had some great people on about foreign policy. Ian Bremmer has been on with us.
Right.
And we've had Joseph Califano. We've had so many people who have helped us to understand where we are today. Many other authors who've really given us their prescriptions about foreign policy. But Michael O'Hanlon is really so knowledgeable. And one of the topics that he really invests a lot of his time and intellectual curiosity in is NATO. Now, John, we've heard a lot about NATO lately because the president has said, well, look, it's great that we're partners with all these European nations, but they've got to cough it up.
All right. They've got to pay
a little bit more.
Share.
That's right.
Yeah.
And so he focuses a lot of our energy on whether our partners have really paid enough. But I think there's another thing we need to focus on, which is the importance of NATO.
Right.
And I think his defense secretary, Mad Dog, Jim Mattis, has said to him, hey, this is what's kept the peace for many, many years since World War II. So, yeah, get him to cough up a little bit more money, but let's not look beyond the importance of this alliance.
Well, I think you're right. I think there's got to be a balance, though, because we also cannot be the police department of the whole world, as we found out. So, I mean, I don't know about coughing up money, but we need them to step up, I think, you know, with helping us do some of the work. You know,
oh, absolutely. I mean, they have to invest their GDP, their forces. But don't forget, some of those forces have been with us in a lot of wild adventures that America has gotten into. And in fact, that Article 5 of the agreement with NATO, we had them come forward right after we were hit after 9/11. So I think that was the first time we actually activated that article. So they have been with us.
Yeah.
There's no question.
No, without a doubt. But I think we try to do all the heavy lifting around the world. And I think, you know, we'll see what he has to say. But, you know, I think we need to share that kind of
responsibility.
Yes.
Well, you know what's interesting, John? And I don't think this has gotten a lot of attention. So if there's a new kernel of information that you're going to be getting, kernel as in K-E-R-N-E-L, not a colonel in the army, you're actually going to hear today about something that I don't think has been on our radar screen. And that is that the NATO that we developed after World War II to make certain that Europe was not going to be a hothouse for the next world war has really changed. It's expanded dramatically.
Let's face it, the world has changed. I mean, look at, we're under attack for networks. I mean, we got the whole battlefield has really changed.
But what I'm saying is we added a lot of new member nations, and those member nations got a whole lot closer to the border of Russia.
Right.
And that has scared the Russians. And they have been realistic about this. I'm not going to say that they've been outsized in terms of their response necessarily. And we'll hear from Michael O'Hanlon about this. But the president did frame this in one sense when he said, hey, do we really want all of our soldiers dying for Montenegro? Now, again, there are lots of things that he says that concern me, but I understand his point. Have we expanded NATO beyond its utility?
Well, you got to wonder that. I mean, here we got, we're cutting off oil supply, I think, in the Balkans. And, you know, there's a whole, we really don't want to get in a war with Russia over this. I mean, the
ultimate goal. And maybe Russia has a point about the fact that we're kind of moving into areas that have a lot of people who define themselves ethnically as Russians. So this is what we're going to talk about today with Michael O'Hanlon. Is there a different security architecture for these countries that do abut Russia that might make us all a little more comfortable, both the NATO allies, the United States, and Russia? Is there a new way of looking at this? And that's what he gets into, which I think is really smart.
Oh, I think so, too. Especially, you know, we seem to have during, especially during the election, the beating the war drums for going to war with Russia. And I think this would be a huge mistake. So,
well, he's got another way of looking at this, John, that I think you are going to find very interesting, as will those who are listening today. And it will give you a different perspective into where we are today with NATO. And forget the dollars. I think that is being worked out. And many of these countries are going to 2% of their GDP. But more importantly, what is NATO's role today? Is it really expanding beyond perhaps its initial intent? And how do we get it back, if we feel that has happened, into a way where some of these countries might have more neutrality and therefore not be a threat to either those in Eastern Europe or those on the Russian border? So that's what we're going to discuss.
Well, I think we should get him on here. I'm anxious to hear this.
Oh, he's great. Michael O'Hanlon today on America Trends. Joining us from the Brookings Institution is Michael O'Hanlon, and he has written a book called Beyond NATO, A New Security Architecture for Eastern Europe. Michael, I don't think many of us have considered the evolution of NATO. We've heard a lot lately about who's paying for what, but in terms of expansion of NATO beyond the initial countries that were part of it, and that's a part of your story, a big part of your story.
Right. Thank you. Well, if you put this in historical perspective, of course, NATO was created 4 years after World War II in 1949, when we started to see the Iron Curtain descend on Europe, and we realized we had a problem, an ongoing problem with the future of European security, and specifically the Soviet and Warsaw Pact threat. And at that time, 12 countries joined this organization, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. Those 12 basically all touched the Atlantic Ocean or were extremely close to it. At that point, we didn't even have Germany in the alliance. Germany was still in this process of rebuilding, and, you know, it was still shaping up into this divided entity. So the initial NATO was basically the UK and France and United States and Italy and a few other countries. And then in the course of the next 40 years during the Cold War, we only added four countries, Spain, Germany, Greece, and Turkey, as the latter two resolved their disputes with each other or partially resolved them and evolved their politics in such a way that it made sense to have them in, and the same thing with Spain. And then, so that made 16 countries in 1989 when the Berlin Wall fell. Now NATO is 29 going on 30 countries. So we've almost doubled the size in the period when NATO supposedly isn't really needed anymore for the purposes that it was originally constructed to achieve. Of course, we've seen Russia now come back and be a problem again. So you could say that a related dilemma confronts us that has some echoes from the Cold War within it. But, you know, that's not really the main purpose of why NATO was created. It faced a specific major Soviet threat from a country that had an ideological ambition bent on world dominion, world domination. So we're just in a different period. We've been using NATO for different purposes. We've been using it largely to try to consolidate democracy and stability in the former Warsaw Pact parts of Europe and also the Baltic states, which, of course, had been annexed by the Soviet Union. But we've been using it differently. It was not originally designed as a democracy promotion entity. It was about territorial defense of core Western interests. And I think we need to remember that and get back a little bit to that.
So did the old Soviet Union that became Russia after Glasnost and Perestroika think that when the Warsaw Pact dissolved, that maybe NATO should take a different role and perhaps they should retract a bit too?
Yeah, I think that's a fair summary of where Russian thinking was. And I don't just mean among the Vladimir Putins of the world, people I have no particular interest in trying to please or assuage, but even the Mikhail Gorbachevs. You know, Gorbachev and the first President Bush and Secretary of State Baker at that time, they spent a lot of effort in the period right around the fall of the Berlin Wall, worried about how to reintegrate Germany. And Baker and Bush promised that we wouldn't even move NATO forces into the territory of the former East Germany. There was a lot of attention given to how to do that in a way that would not disrupt the new, you know, spirit of not just detente, but of harmony that seemed to be prevailing in Europe. And later on, as the 1990s went forward and President Clinton ultimately chose to do that first round of NATO expansion and brought in Poland and Hungary and the Czech Republic and Slovakia, which at that time, you know, were joined as Czechoslovakia, Gorbachev warned us. He said, don't do this, and it's not going to play well in Russia. It's not going to be well received in Russia. It's going to hurt Russia's evolution towards a more democratic, peaceful, stable country. And so those kinds of voices were also against even the initial rounds of NATO expansion. In fairness, I think we have to acknowledge that we achieved some good things in those periods, stabilizing countries like Poland. Mm-hmm. And also, we worked pretty hard to deal with Russian anxieties, and we did not station NATO forces in the new territories of the new members. We set up some dialogues and mechanisms for Russia to be very involved with NATO, present at NATO meetings. Frankly, if Russia had been in a healthier state of its democracy and, frankly, been a little more reasonable, I don't think we would have had the kind of allergic reaction that we saw. But countries being what they are and Russia being what it was at that time and the Russian psyche on these kinds of issues being grounded in a history that's made them very proud but also maybe at times a little paranoid and at times a little petulant, when you put all that together, the conditions were set for a bad reaction from Russia. And especially as the process then continued under President Bush, the second President Bush, and we brought in the Baltic states and other former members of the Warsaw Pact, that set the conditions for, as Vladimir Putin also came into the Kremlin, that set the conditions for a stronger and stronger Russian pushback.
Well, you reminded us in the book that even Boris Yeltsin said that NATO expansion could bring what he called a cold peace. Is that where we are?
Well, I don't know that it's all that cold, unfortunately. You know, if we were just in a state of stability where we didn't like each other much and were a little mad at each other but weren't acting dangerously around each other, I wouldn't be quite so concerned. So I think it's a little worse than cold peace. I think there's a risk of war. And I don't think the risk is all that high, but it's higher than it should be between two nuclear-armed superpowers who really should not be so transfixed by the details of what happens in Eastern Europe that we can actually plausibly imagine paths to war and even nuclear war over these kinds of dynamics. I find that deeply unsettling. I'm not trying to scare anybody. I'm not saying the chances of this kind of thing happening are high. But again, we've got Russian aircraft and ships, you know, approaching and buzzing NATO assets. We've got Russians carrying out cyber attacks against NATO members like Estonia. We saw what they did to our democracy a couple of years ago. We've seen Russia continue to harass and attack Ukraine in many ways. There's the potential. Now, Ukraine's not in NATO, but the other countries I mentioned are. There's the potential here for something to snowball and get out of hand, and that's what I'm worried about.
Well, of course, you remind us that our situation after the 1994 Budapest Memorandum commits us to looking at the Ukraine in a light that might involve a response if they are attacked. And some say they have been attacked and are continually being attacked. And we're holding out what you call perhaps, misleading birth of a relationship between Ukraine, Georgia, and NATO. Where are they in that process right now?
They're nowhere. And let me go back first to your good point about the Budapest Memorandum. So in 1994, Ukraine did a fantastic thing for the good of the world. They gave up all their nuclear weapons, a couple thousand of them, which they inherited at the end of the Cold War and the demise of the Soviet Union when it splintered into its 15 constituent republics. And Ukraine was left holding a couple thousand weapons. And rather than build a nuclear force of its own, it agreed to surrender those to the international community, essentially back to Russia, and dismantle some weapons. And then London, Washington, and Moscow essentially made an informal, formal but non-Senate ratified, non-treaty binding commitment to help ensure the security of Ukraine. There were no specifics about how that would be done. Again, there was not a ratification by the U.S. Senate. There was no ironclad commitment of American lives in defense of Ukraine should conditions so warrant. But there was still a strong statement by President Clinton in the White House at the time that this was something we took seriously and we would consider ourselves committed to helping to promote Ukraine's security. So when Russia violated that pledge some years later, I don't think we had the same kind of obligation to come to Ukraine's defense that we do for NATO members, but we could not claim to have complete innocence and, you know, distance from the problem either. So that's a little bit of a dilemma, and that's part of why I worked hard in my book to propose a security architecture that I thought might do more for Ukraine than this distant prospect of NATO membership, which we're not making any headway towards whatsoever. And the basic situation there is that President Bush, the second Bush, in 2008, after a big NATO summit in Bucharest, he promised, or got the rest of NATO to also promise, that someday Ukraine and Georgia would join NATO. But there was no promise about when, and there was no interim security guarantee. And there was also the ongoing and longstanding NATO policy, you can't join the alliance unless you've solved your problems with your neighbors, regardless of who caused those problems. If you put that together, no imminent and no near-term membership, no interim security guarantee, and no eligibility if you still have problems with Russia. And this creates a perfect set of perverse incentives for Russia to want to monkey around in Ukraine, keep them weak, keep them divided, keep them ineligible for NATO membership, and meanwhile know that NATO is not going to respond militarily. So I think the 2008 Bucharest summit was badly handled, and in any event, it hasn't worked. And we need a new paradigm that would look for a better approach than NATO membership. We still say in theory Georgia and Ukraine can join NATO someday, but no one wants them in anytime soon. And so the time when they need protection the most is the time they're not getting it.
And I do want to go into that architecture that you are describing and proposing, but I want to go back to the 2007 Munich Security Conference, and Putin gave the following remarks, and you quote them in the book. "It turns out that NATO has put its frontline forces on our borders, and we continue to strictly fulfill the treaty obligations and do not react to these actions at all. I think it is obvious that NATO expansion does not have any relation with the modernization of the alliance itself or with ensuring security in Europe. On the contrary, it represents a serious provocation that reduces the level of mutual trust." I mean, he certainly told us what he was thinking at that time.
Yeah, Putin is not a guy who, he lies for tactical purposes, but when he explains his worldview, he often expresses it pretty consistently and pretty forthrightly and sometimes, you know, almost as a warning of what's coming. Now, I would challenge a number of the things he said in that Munich speech. For example, the idea that NATO had a lot of frontline forces near Russian borders is wrong. It's only in the last couple of years that we've even put up to 5,000 lightly armed infantry troops in the Baltic states and Poland, once we've perceived this much more serious threat since 2014, which of course was the year that Russia annexed Crimea and otherwise carried out aggressions against Ukraine. So I think Putin tells his own version of history. He may be honest about how he views it. His facts are often incorrect. His interpretation is often very self-serving and reflects a Russian, you know, anger and, again, almost a pettiness at times. NATO had worked so hard to persuade Russia that we wanted to dialogue with them, that we wanted to avoid stoking security problems in Eastern Europe, that the alliance was not directed against them. Most of NATO was dramatically downsizing military budgets. Of course, that's what Donald Trump's been complaining about. And what that meant was NATO didn't really have the power to threaten Russia, even if it wanted to. So I think Putin's worldview needs to be challenged. And I try to walk the fine line in the book of not buying into his worldview, but still recognizing that it's sincerely felt by him and by many other Russians.
Right. We have to deal with that perception. I want to ask you about some of the things that America did after we won the Cold War and how that played in terms of the perception of Russia as to what America's goals were. I mean, tell us, when we were the sole superpower left on the world stage, how do you think we have responded in the last 25 years or so?
Well, I think, as is often the case in American foreign policy, our intentions are usually pretty good. Our executions often pretty mediocre. I think, for example, in the 1990s, we had a great aversion to casualties, and so a lot of our operations were delayed, or we pulled out. We pulled out of Somalia pretty quickly after we lost some troops there. We didn't stop the Rwanda genocide. We didn't stop the Bosnia ethnic cleansing for many years. But on the other hand, you know, we were trying to do something about some of these problems in our own limited way, and we ultimately struggled to some partial success in Bosnia and Kosovo. When bin Laden declared war on us in 98, and well, the embassy bombings in Africa occurred in 98 anyway, we responded, I think, pretty meekly. And that was unfortunate for our own safety, as subsequent events revealed. But in the 1990s, we were sort of a, you know, we were sometimes described as a unipolar superpower or the hyperpower, the only superpower left, but we didn't actually exercise our military muscle very forthrightly. That changed after 9/11, and of course, most people would say that the wars that have ensued have been controversial, expensive, difficult, most difficult of all for our own men and women in uniform and the peoples of places like Iraq and Afghanistan. We didn't cause those problems, but we had a imperfect way of solving them. Most people would say it wasn't worth the full effort, at least not in both places. And I think, you know, that's an American critique of our own success, or lack thereof. And Putin would amplify that and put it on steroids and just say we were the bumbling hyperpower, didn't know what, you know, how to use our own power. We would uproot perfectly acceptable leaders or have these naive impressions and views of how we could make the Middle East a much better place, and we wind up just making things worse. And so that's a big part of his worldview. And he also thinks that we deliberately are trying to subvert his rule in Russia and other people around him in the former Soviet space who govern like him, sort of as autocrats. So the so-called colored revolutions in Ukraine and Georgia and Central Asia, he feels that we were being malicious, probably covert, doing the same kinds of things to them, to those countries, and to Russia that we complain that Russia did to us in 2016 in our elections. Putin thinks he was just getting some payback by 2016 for what had happened before. So these are the various events that happened in the quarter century after the Cold War that shaped Putin's view of us.
Would Kosovo, which was NATO's first war against Yugoslavia, the military atrocities against ethnic Albanians, you say that it did shake Putin and his sense of expansion by NATO into the Balkans?
Yeah, you know, I supported that Kosovo intervention. And I don't think Putin had a reasonable basis to critique it, but he felt that, and he was just coming into the Kremlin at that time, he felt that historical Russian prerogatives towards Serbia, their close friendship, you know, were being violated, that the only remaining friends left in Europe, only remaining friends of Russia left in the heartland of Europe were being systematically picked off by the West, that we were, again, taking advantage of our military dominance and our high technology to fight this war from the air. And he didn't think much of what we were doing. I think he was wrong to believe that Milosevic should somehow be given free rein to continue his atrocities. So again, you don't have to buy into Putin's worldview or his each and every criticism of the United States and NATO to see that he really does believe it. And it's just, you know, it's been too frequent and too consistent in his refrain, in his argument against American foreign policy, to think that it's just invented. It's deeply felt. It's a peculiar and particular view of history. With regard to Kosovo, I think it's particularly wrong, and that war wound up, you know, turning out pretty well for a lot of the parties involved, and Putin should have been actually giving us a little credit, but he interpreted this as yet one more effort by the West to throw its power around, and largely at Russian expense.
Now, you believe that NATO expansion has gone far enough and we need a new security architecture. Explain what that would look like.
Well, it's a simple concept because the main thing it's doing is just agreeing where membership will stop and where it might continue for organizations that already exist. So I'm not proposing the creation of any new security system or organization, but I'm suggesting a deal. And the deal has to be good for everybody, so Ukraine and Georgia need to like it too. And the deal would basically have the following parts. First of all, we don't expand NATO any further, especially into the former Soviet republics. You can have good debates about Sweden and Finland and Macedonia, but I would not expand into the former Soviet republics. But second, because Putin should not have any control over those countries and Russia should not be able to view them as vassal states or its sphere of influence, those countries need to be allowed to join the European Union and any other organization committed to economic and scientific and social and cultural advancement, as any other sovereign state would, if they're ever eligible and invited to join and they wish to join. So again, you don't create new institutions, but you reaffirm and clarify the right of countries like Ukraine and Georgia to join if they're invited to do so. Third, you would preserve existing security cooperation with the United States and some of these countries at the lower levels of peacekeeping and counterterrorism and, you know, small exercises that we sometimes do even today with countries like Ukraine and Georgia. They should have some ability to learn from Western militaries. They shouldn't be completely cut off from those kinds of actors. And we should be able to benefit from our collaboration with them. For example, the Georgians have really done a lot to help us in Iraq and Afghanistan, and we should value that and want to be able to continue that kind of cooperation. And then fourth and crucially, Russia needs to solve its territorial disputes with Ukraine and with Georgia to the mutual satisfaction of everyone. I think we might have to finesse Crimea. I'm not sure it's going to be realistic for Ukraine to get Crimea back. But everything else, there need to be agreements that Russia's going to have to stop its aggressions, pull its forces back, stop essentially infringing on the sovereignty of these nation states, that it does not have any right to, compromise in that regard at any time, now or in the future. And if all that happens on NATO, on the EU, on peacekeeping, on Ukraine and Georgia and the disputes, then we also lift the sanctions that have been imposed since 2014, primarily, against Russia, and we go back to a more harmonious vision for the future of Europe. So that's the basic package. And again, nothing is elaborate. This could probably be worked out within weeks if the parties committed themselves. And most of it's just sort of very straightforward based on relationships to existing organizations.
Well, given the unusual relationship with Russia now and the relationship between our two leaders and what President Trump said about Montenegro in terms of, are we really going to go to war if called upon to defend them? I mean, is this a good time for this? Do you think that in the 2 hours that nobody knows really what was discussed, anything like this might have been on the table?
I don't think it was. I've been trying to get my ideas into the Trump administration with limited success, and other people, of course, have had related ideas too, but I don't know that any of them are being pursued. My guess is President Trump has no particular interest in expanding NATO in a major way, although now, after the summit of recent times, we've promised that the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia can be eligible, and this is sort of like Montenegro, a tiny little mini country that frankly doesn't help NATO military capacity and gives us one more obligation. So that's why I think President Trump said what he did about Montenegro to Tucker Carlson. Still, it was a mistake, because you can't get into the business as leader of the United States of saying which allies matter to you more than others. You can't get into the business of allowing a potential aggressor to think there are certain things they can get away with because your commitment is not rock solid. Once a country like Montenegro is in, we're committed, which is part of why I don't want to include many more countries in NATO, because this commitment to their defense is solemn and unimpeachable and uncompromisable based on how the treaty is written. So the decisive moment is at that decision point where they might be brought in or not. And my view is we've got to find a new paradigm for countries that are not currently in. President Trump did make it harder, you're right. His whole history with Russia, with the elections of 2016, it compromises the integrity of this kind of a debate, and it makes it harder for him to be the champion of a new idea like this. So I regret every single time he reopens these kinds of wounds and repeats these kinds of mistakes. But I'll give him credit for at least one small thing. I believe his instinct that we should be able to get along better with Russia, and that we should not be, you know, talking about the possibility of war against Russia at this late date in history. I think he's right about those points, and that there's got to be some way to walk back some of the invective, some of the poison, the toxicity that currently characterizes the relationship. So on that central instinct of his, I support President Trump. I just don't think that he's found a way to translate it into meaningful policy or to have any, you know, any viable way to achieve that goal in the way he's proceeding now.
What did go wrong? I mean, when Russia became what it has become and divested of these other countries and the like, what went wrong? Because we were starting that kind of relationship with Gorbachev, with Yeltsin. And then, of course, we were told that there were all these resets that were going on under different administrations, and they all foundered. Well, what happened here?
Well, some Russians, I mean, this is sort of a good summary place in the conversation to, in a way, just bring it all together. Some Russians resented even the initial rounds of NATO expansion, thought it was the Western world rubbing their face in the defeat they suffered in the Cold War, and we should have been thanking them for dismantling the Warsaw Pact and the Soviet Union, not building up an exclusionary alliance right up to their borders. That was part of it. Others felt that the way in which we handled the conflicts of the Middle East proved that we couldn't be trusted, and that we were bent on regime change and we were willing to use a lot of force, and maybe that regime change would even extend to former Soviet republics. And then our support for the colored revolutions, for democracy movements in places like Ukraine and Georgia and Russia affected people like Putin. But let's also not, I don't want to put the blame all on us. Putin's a bad guy. I mean, he's corrupt. His cronies are corrupt. They also worried that if the European Union expanded into places like the former Soviet republics, it would make Russia more of a standout as a country that's got all these nepotistic good old boy networks that essentially are robbing from other Russians and preventing Putin from running, you know, sort of a mafia-like state at his own benefit and the benefit of his inner circle. And so to some extent, it was the Western values and legal principles and, you know, democratic institutions that Putin feared. And he would wrap up his disdain for those kinds of characteristics of the West in language and in criticisms that sounded more, you know, more palatable to us or more reasonable, you know, blaming us for the Iraq War or blaming us for NATO expansion, places where he could get some traction with Western critics and Western dissidents as well. And this is where, you know, I try to be careful. I don't want to sound like I'm a Putin supporter or a sympathizer. So part of it is that we gave him cover to do things that he might have wanted to do internally to shore up his own autocracy within Russia. And we allowed him to construct a narrative that made it easier for him to do that. That's why I think NATO expansion has actually harmed, in a regrettable way, Russian democracy, because it's allowed someone like Putin to hijack rhetoric that sounds so noble and so reasonable, but in fact is partly a smokescreen for bad things he wants to do within his own country, even to his own people.
And it must play well to the Russian psychology that the rest of the world is at their doorstep and not understanding their history and all of their attributes. But the core concept of your new security architecture seems to me to be permanent neutrality. Has that worked well historically? If we're looking for other precedents to what it is that you're proposing, should we have confidence in the notion of permanent neutrality?
Well, there are plenty of places where in Europe today it works. Switzerland, Austria, arguably Finland and Sweden, although those two countries are reassessing in light of the behavior they see going on within Russia. Ireland, there are a number of other countries that are not members of NATO or, you know, or not members of the European Union or otherwise going their own way. And I think that the run-up to the world wars, and especially World War I, makes me think that we should keep NATO, that neutrality writ large is not good, because then countries get paranoid and they start forming secret alliances, and the alliances may or may not be dependable. And so, you know, I think it's good that we have a strong NATO in Europe. I was in favor of keeping NATO after the Cold War. But I think that there are places where NATO makes more sense than others. It makes sense most for those core Western states where we have the greatest common bonds and the greatest strategic interests. We don't want to see Germany or Britain or France or other major powers, you know, captured or somehow controlled by a hostile foreign entity. So the original logic for NATO forming and keeping these major industrial centers working together collaboratively, I think, was good. But it doesn't mean that Sweden or Switzerland or Austria or, you know, any other particular country needs to be in. And certainly for the former Soviet republics, where the psychological stakes are so high for Russian pride, and, you know, to some extent for Russian sense of psychological security, even if not military security per se, I think there we need a different solution. Most countries in the world are basically neutral. Mm. South America, Latin America, Africa, Southeast Asia. Most countries in the world don't have big, strong, working military alliances like we do. I value the ones we've got, but I think we should realize that alliance expansion for its own sake is not the natural way of the world.
Well, it's a brief book. It's less than 120 pages, but very important. Lots of history that is really important for us to understand, and this new security architecture for Eastern Europe. And it is thought-provoking indeed. Beyond NATO, Michael O'Hanlon. Thank you for being with us today on America Trends.
My pleasure. Thank you.